Known for revolutionizing chemistry and conducting groundbreaking experiments during the Enlightenment, Antoine Lavoisier and his wife Marie-Anne are today known as the father and mother of modern chemistry. Antoine also revolutionized French gunpowder, which helped his country win wars and even aided in the American Revolution. But during the bloodiest days of the French Revolution, none of that would help him. Today, we're going to take a look at how the father and mother of modern chemistry were utterly destroyed by the French Revolution. But before we get started, be sure to subscribe to the Weird History Channel and let us know in the comments below what other science and education history topics you would like to hear about. Okay, while the revolution may not have been televised, we've got you covered. Most people have heard of Marie and Pierre Curie, the scientific couple who, among other things, discovered radium. But Antoine and Marie-Anne Lavoisier were the OG science power couple. In the 18th century, Antoine led the chemical revolution, established the law of conservation of mass, and named several elements, including oxygen, hydrogen, and carbon. Together, the Lavoisiers worked to build on Joseph Priestley's groundbreaking research on oxygen and promote a lab-based approach to chemistry. However, the Lavoisiers were also aristocrats, and Antoine was a former tax collector, which was not a great thing to be during the French Revolution. Unfortunately, when the Reign of Terror turned its sights on Antoine, his cutting-edge scientific achievements couldn't protect him. During the 1700s, most scientists believed in the phlogiston theory, which, long story short, supposedly explained why things burn. Antoine Lavoisier disagreed with the concept and argued that the so-called dephlogisticated air was really what his acquaintance and rival Joseph Priestley had identified as oxygen. The friendly rivalry between Priestley and Lavoisier produced volumes of correspondence detailing their findings. History credits both Priestley and Lavoisier for discovering oxygen, though Priestley believed he had found dephlogisticated air. It was actually Antoine who identified the gas and gave it the name oxygen, which was derived from the Greek word for acid maker. Antoine Lavoisier is highly renowned for the elements he named, as well as the law of conservation of mass. During the chemical revolution, Antoine argued that elements of set weights comprise the world, and he tested that theory in 1772 by burning a diamond. How did that work? Well, during the experiment, Antoine placed a diamond in a sealed jar and focused light on it using an enormous magnifying glass. The diamond burned and seemed to disappear completely, yet Antoine found the weight of the jar and its contents had not changed. He used this result to demonstrate how mass conservation is a law of nature. In later tests, Antoine determined that a burning diamond and charcoal produced the same gas, carbon dioxide. The discovery convinced him that both diamond and charcoal contained the same element, which he named carbon. As if discovering and naming oxygen and carbon weren't enough, the Lavoisiers also spent years of research exploring the nature of respiration and combustion. It paid off. Ultimately, they proved that, from a chemical standpoint, the two processes were actually identical. They did this by designing several tests to measure breathing and the heat given off during respiration. In one experiment, for example, Antoine used his laboratory tools to measure the heat and carbon dioxide emitted from a guinea pig's exhalation. He then burned carbon to produce an equal amount of carbon dioxide to prove it created the same amount of heat. This revolutionary research explained why mammals have a body temperature higher than room temperature. Antoine Lavoisier's scientific research was invaluable to the chemistry community. But scientists weren't the only ones to benefit. It also helped the French army. In 1775, Antoine joined the Royal Gunpowder and Saltpeter Administration, a research group dedicated to augmenting gunpowder. As a commissioner, Antoine created a laboratory to study gunpowder's constituent parts. Antoine worked with potassium nitrate, sulfur, and charcoal to enhance gunpowder, and his tests revealed a better way to granulate the powder. The project, which was initially started by King Louis XVI because he was concerned that France wasn't self-sufficient in the manufacture of gunpowder, was such a success that the country soon had excess quantities of gunpowder available for export. Interestingly, one of the major beneficiaries of this surplus would be the soldiers in George Washington's army, who were busy fighting the American Revolution. The Lavoisiers were only able to revolutionize chemistry because of their advanced equipment, and they only had the equipment because in 1783, Antoine had designated Jean-Nicolas Fortin as his instrument maker. The couple needed the best tools to conduct precise chemical experiments. And Fortin, who also worked with French innovators like Pierre Dulong and Gay Lussac, was experienced at designing gear for scientists. In his most famous work, Elements of Chemistry, Antoine included detailed drawings showing 170 different pieces of laboratory devices. Marie-Anne had drawn each diagram to scale, showing the flasks, furnaces, and jars the pair used to uncover new scientific principles. Marie-Anne Pierrette Pauls was only 13 when she married the 28-year-old Antoine Lavoisier. That seems very young, but then again, it was a very different time. If it makes you feel any better, Antoine's biographer, Douglas Mackay, said that the marriage was a happy one, in part because Marie-Anne became Antoine's most important scientific collaborator. According to Mackay, Marie-Anne was possessed of a high intelligence. She took a great interest in her husband's scientific work and rapidly equipped herself to share in his labors. Mackay further states that Marie-Anne helped Antoine in the laboratory and drew sketches of his experiments. On top of all that, she made many of the entries in his laboratory notebooks. Marie-Anne also learned English so she could translate and comment on the latest research reports from Britain and engage with scientific contemporaries. If treating her as an intellectual partner and a professional equal isn't enough to ease your mind about the significant age gap, know that Antoine only originally agreed to marry the teenage Marie-Anne so she wouldn't have to marry someone more than three times her age. In 1771, the Count d'Amerval, a middle-aged man, threatened to fire Marie-Anne's father from his tax company if he could not marry Marie-Anne. Something that seems like it should be illegal, but at the time, it wasn't. Marie-Anne's father needed a reason to refuse the powerful aristocrat, so he asked his associate, Antoine, to marry Marie-Anne instead. Antoine and Marie-Anne wed in 1771 and remained together until Antoine's death during the French Revolution. Given that they were dedicated scientist types, the Lavoisiers often spent their days in the laboratory. Antoine was typically the one directing experiments, while Marie-Anne managed the schedule and recorded the results. Madame Lavoisier wrote that her husband believed any day in the lab was a good one. According to her, it was for him a day of happiness. She described how much her husband loved going to the lab in the mornings to meet with some friends who shared his views and some young men proud to be admitted to the honor of collaborating in his experiments. Antoine was often at the center of the conversations, as his wife recalled. It was there that you could have heard this man with his precise mind, his clear intelligence, his high genius, the loftiness of his philosophical principles, illuminating his conversation. Antoine Lavoisier's groundbreaking book, Elements of Chemistry, debuted in 1789, which unfortunately was the same year the French Revolution turned his country upside down. The Lavoisiers initially supported the revolution, and Antoine worked with the new government to establish the metric system across France. But Antoine also acknowledged that the disruption affected his work, and in 1790, he wrote that the state of public affairs in France has temporarily retarded the progress of science and distracted scientists from the work that is most precious to them. He didn't know it when he wrote that, but being distracted was going to quickly become the least of his concerns. Only a few years later, Antoine received a death warrant with his name on it. For centuries, people across Europe hated tax collectors, which isn't too hard to believe, because who likes a tax collector, even now? But France's financial problems compelled citizens to particularly despise them in the years before the French Revolution. The French tax system protected the elite from taxes and levied most of the burden on the Third Estate, which was comprised of peasants, merchants, and artisans. The collection system rested on using tax farmers, and some extorted their districts to keep the excess for themselves. Antoine Lavoisier had once served as a tax collector, and though his wife wasn't one, she was the daughter of one, and that certainly didn't help the couple's popularity. As the French Revolution grew more radical, many people began to view all aristocrats with suspicion. In 1793, at the dawn of the Reign of Terror, the revolutionaries disbanded the French Academy of Sciences, the most important scientific society in the country. 2 years earlier, members of the Academy, including Antoine Lavoisier, had helped create the metric system for France. But the revolutionaries declared the Academy elitist. Talk about being ungrateful. In 1794, the revolutionary government declared Antoine a traitor. He faced accusations of conspiring with foreign scientists and sending money to France's enemies. The government issued his death warrant. It probably didn't make him feel any better about being executed, but the Reign of Terror didn't single out Antoine Lavoisier. In fact, the government arrested anyone and everyone who participated in the tax collecting group, including Marie Anne's father. On May 8, 1794, a revolutionary tribunal convicted Antoine of conspiracy against the people of France. The revolutionaries did not wait long to carry out the death sentence. Hours later, Antoine found himself staring down the national razor. He was 50 years old when he died. They also executed Marie Anne's father that day. It was a rough day all around. After his execution, Antoine Lavoisier was mourned by scientists around the world. To drive home how irreplaceable Antoine was, mathematician Joseph-Louis Lagrange said of the execution, "It took them only an instant to cut off that head, and 100 years may not produce another like it." Marie Anne continued to promote her husband's work. She published his papers in 1805, and after the Reign of Terror was over, she hosted a scientific salon in Paris. She even went on to marry another scientist, Benjamin Thompson. Just a year after executing Antoine, the French government voided the trial and declared the scientist innocent. Antoine was only one of the thousands who died during the French Revolution, but his story is one of the most tragic. So what do you think? How important were the Lavoisiers to chemistry? Let us know in the comments below, and while you're at it, check out some of these other videos from our weird history.